Good morning and welcome to the seventh meeting of the Public Audit and Post-Legislative Scrutiny Committee. Can I ask all those present to either switch off their electronic devices or switch them to silent mode so they don't affect the work of the committee this morning? Item one, the committee is invited to agree to take items 5, 6 and 7 in private. Item 5 is consideration of evidence received under item 2 on the NHS in Scotland 2016 report. Item 6 is consideration of evidence received under item 3 on the NHS 24 report. And item 7 is consideration of evidence received under item 4 on the NHS Tayside report. Do members agree to take these items in private? Thank you. Item number 2 is an evidence session on the Auditor General for Scotland's report, NHS in Scotland 2016. And I'd like to welcome to the meeting this morning Caroline Gardner, Auditor General for Scotland, Angela Canning, Assistant Director, Carol Calder, Senior Manager, and Gillian Matthew, Audit Manager at Audit Scotland. I now invite the Auditor General to make her opening statement before I open up to questions from members.
Thank you, Convener. Today I'm bringing to the committee my annual overview report on the NHS in Scotland. It looks at the performance of NHS boards during 2015-16 and comments on the challenges and pressures facing the NHS. It also looks ahead to assess what progress the government is making towards delivering public service reform, including its ambition for everyone to live longer, healthier lives at home or in a homely setting by 2020. Over the last decade, there have been real improvements in the way health services are delivered. The time that patients wait for hospital treatment has reduced, treatment is safer, and hospital-related infections have dropped. Overall, people are living longer and are now more likely to survive conditions like heart disease. These improvements are a testament to the hard-working staff of the NHS who provide a vital service for all of us here in Scotland. But the health of Scotland's population is relatively poor compared to other developed countries, and significant health inequalities still exist. I have highlighted in previous reports the challenges that NHS boards are facing. They're finding it increasingly difficult to achieve financial balance, and many used short-term measures to break even in 2015-16. The percentage of non-recurring savings has increased, and for the current year, boards are setting higher savings targets, an average of 4.8%. The total planned savings of £492 million in 2016-17 are 65% higher than in 2015-16. This will put considerable pressure on the NHS this year, and there's a significant risk that some boards will not be able to remain within their budgets. Overall, NHS spending isn't keeping pace with the growing and ageing population, increasing demand and rising costs. NHS funding has increased each year since 2008-09, but the small real terms increases of less than 1% over that period have been below the general inflation rate and well below the higher health inflation rate, which was estimated at 3% in 2016-17. The committee may remember that we analysed the increasing demand for health and social care services in our report on changing models of health and social care. In today's report, we highlight a range of cost pressures, including rising drug costs, staff costs, achieving national waiting times, and new technologies. It's clear that the NHS cannot continue to provide services in the same way within the resources available. The government has had a policy to shift the balance of care for over a decade. It's published several strategies for reducing the use of hospitals and supporting more people at home, but most spending is still on hospitals and other institution-based care. Some progress is being made in shifting to new models of care, but it's not happening fast enough to meet the growing need. My report sets out a number of recommendations to increase the pace of change, including a clear plan with measures or milestones to allow progress to be assessed. There also needs to be financial modelling and a funding plan for implementation of the strategy, a clear workforce plan to ensure the right staff with the right skills for new ways of working, and continuing engagement with the public about the future of health services. The Cabinet Secretary has accepted our recommendations and committed to publishing a delivery plan by the end of the year, which will bring together the various strands of reform underway, and I welcome that commitment. Convener, my colleagues and I are happy to answer the committee's questions.
Thank you very much. I now open to questions, and the first question is from Alison Harris.
Good morning. Well, I really would just like to ask further questions in relation to the recruitment and training of staff. you know, my major concerns are obviously, you know, without trainees going forward into the specialists, you know, the specialist trainee things, you have unfilled vacancies, as you've stated, in old age psychiatry and clinical oncology. You know, that will be a major problem going forward as the population gets older, etc. But I was wondering, did you do any work to look at the fact that junior doctors, when they do their 2 years to become GMC registered, they all seem to, or mostly all seem to be doing that element of it, but then it seems to be the next step when they go into specialities. Has any work been done from Audit Scotland to see why? You know, are they not taking up the posts, or are they, what's causing that drop off?
A timely question. What this report does is pull together the evidence from the audit of each of the, particularly the 14 territorial health boards during 15-16. But the last couple of reports have highlighted pressures on the NHS workforce, and we're just about to start a new performance audit looking specifically at those questions and drilling down into the higher level findings we've got here.
Right, because, you know, I certainly think that's something that does need drilled down. We need to know why we have the junior doctors at this level, but they're not going on to take the specialist training, you know, posts. So I look forward to seeing that report. I had one other question. Do you want me to ask? Could I just ask, in relation to on page 12, you were discussing the fact, you know, about balancing budgets, etc. There seems to be quite a wee bit, in paragraph 18, it seems to be a wee bit creative accounting in order to balance the budgets, and that concerns me. You know, I think the more creative they are, the more easy it seems, or the better it is for balancing, and therefore they think they're okay. So do you have any thoughts on that?
You're right. As accountants, we look for the areas where there is a risk that people are, to a greater or lesser extent, sort of flexing the figures to hit a target this year, which is very often simply pushing a problem into the next year. We talk about one specific instance in the report here, where Esher and Aaron had made a prepayment for holidays, which the auditor concluded was simply not acceptable. And Ayrshire and Aaron restated its figures and increased the pressure on achieving its break-even position. We absolutely rely on the auditors that I appoint to each of the health boards to be making sure that proper accounting practice is being used. And given the attention that's focused on both the revenue and the capital resource limit, the actions, the transactions that boards undertake to hit those measures are an area that they do pay particular attention to, as you would expect.
Thank you. I'll open it to others.
Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Mayor. Auditor General, as is so often the case, the reports coming forward give sort of mixed information. Clearly, it highlights the challenging financial situation that all the public sector is facing. But I'm pleased to see there's a lot of positive stuff in here as well, with improvements in overall health, life expectancy, patient safety, survival rates for certain conditions and reduction in delayed discharges. I mean, these are positive things. That doesn't take away the fact that, of course, there's a great deal of pressure in this sector. And I'd like to just focus on one or two points there. On page 15, paragraph 28, there was a conclusion that adequate accounting records had not been kept in relation to elements of property, plant and equipment assets, which is pretty basic stuff. Has that been rectified?
I'll ask Gillian to come in on the detail in that one. I think it's fair to say that's actually relatively unusual now, that most NHS boards do have decent records of their assets and manage them well. There was a particular instance in Shetland this year, as you've highlighted. Gillian.
Yes, the issue in Shetland was that they had recorded the assets that had been purchased, but there hadn't been adequate records kept about disposal or sale of the assets. So the assets that were looked at were quite old, and the board had assumed that they had been sold or disposed of, but they didn't actually have the records that hadn't been kept up to date on the asset register. So the auditor has worked closely with the board about that, and improvements have been made, and that the auditors have been assured that that's not going to be a problem in the future.
Thank you. Just looking again at page 17, paragraph 29 and probably 30-31, there's been a small improvement in the NHS estate in that time. Would that be correct to say?
I think it's probably fair to say, but as you'll see from reading through the paragraph, it's slightly more nuanced than that. The change in each of the categories from the good condition through to unsatisfactory are move in different directions. So there is a small improvement, but there is also a significant amount of the estate that still needs significant investment to bring it up to an appropriate standard.
Looking at page 19, paragraph 39, I see the statement that Scotland, along with the rest of the UK, has one of the highest generic prescribing rates in the world. Now, prescription of generic drugs generally reduces costs, and yet I think, if I remember correctly, prescriptions are something like 12% of the cost of the NHS, which seems an awful lot, and we're seeing year-on-year inflation-busting increases in the cost of drugs. So is this switch to generic prescribing actually having the impact that one would hope?
I think if you look at the long term, it had a very significant impact. We've reported on GP prescribing in its own right on at least two occasions over the last decade or so. And we've seen both significant increases in the generic prescribing rate and real savings as a result of that, to the extent where it looked as though the remaining savings that were available to achieve were pretty small. What's changed, I think, has been conditions in the market, where the supply of some of the unbranded generic drugs has been restricted for different reasons and the price has risen. Gillian might want to add a bit of detail to that.
I think, just to echo what Caroline said, that there have been a lot of savings made through switching to generic prescribing, but there are a lot of issues that have arisen over the last couple of years around prescribing of drugs. So the number of people receiving drugs, or the number of drugs that people are receiving, so the items prescribed is going up, you know, linked to the ageing population. There's more drugs have been approved, and there's been new drugs for rare conditions that are very expensive that boards are having to finance now as well. So there's a lot of pressures from various sources that are causing the overall increase, and the Scottish Government are predicting that's going to continue over the foreseeable future, probably around 5 to 10% increase each year. So that's a big pressure for boards at the moment.
And the statement's also made that in the 2013 report on GP prescribing, that most of the potential savings have already been achieved. So there's not a great deal to be got out of that now, I would assume.
As I say, in relation to generic prescribing, Scotland made real advances over the last decade, and we do think that most of the savings have been achieved. The challenge is in new drugs coming through, increasing levels of prescription for some conditions, like the prescription of statins, and very significant increases in the price of some drugs where the supply is restricted to one or two manufacturers, or a new supplier has bought the rights to manufacture and has made very significant increases in the price. And we've tried to set some of that out on the following couple of pages, where there are examples of drugs to which that applies.
I also noticed in here that there's a fairly high proportion of prescriptions are for over-the-counter drugs, which seems odd.
It's a policy matter to ask government about. There may be good clinical reasons for prescribing things like ibuprofen, which is one of the ones that we identify in the report, to a particular patient, but clearly most of us can simply purchase over-the-counter drugs when we need them. There may be some particular preparations of the drug, there may be some patients where it simply is more appropriate for the health service to fund that than for the individual to do it, but it seems like an area that's worth looking at, particularly since we highlight that the cost of paracetamol, ibuprofen and antihistamines was around £17 million last year to the health service. That's a significant amount of money.
And just briefly turning to the use of agency staff, which seems quite disproportionately high. The statement's made that there's difficulty for the NHS recruiting staff, and that seems to be at almost all levels. Would that be correct?
We highlight in the report that the NHS is facing problems in recruiting and retaining its staff. It does affect different parts of the country differently, and different specialisms and types of staff as well. The challenge for the NHS, I think, is that in most circumstances they must have a member of staff there, both for patient quality and for patient safety reasons. And therefore, if there is a gap in the rota, bringing in a temporary member of staff can't be avoided. We say in the report, and we've reported in more detail previously, that the way you do that really matters as a short-term fix. On the whole, having your own bank both is cheaper and provides higher quality of care than having to use an agency would. And obviously the longer term solution is to draw back and look at workforce planning in the way that Ms. Harris was suggesting earlier.
You may not have an answer to this, but is it more profitable or is it better paid to be an agency staff than it is to be a permanent employee of the NHS?
And we haven't looked at this in depth recently, but the last time we looked at it, it appeared that the drivers were more about the flexibility for staff, that they were able to choose their own working hours and location in ways that were less available if they were on the permanent establishment of a hospital or other healthcare setting. It costs the health service more to use an agency because there's both VAT and commission involved, but it doesn't necessarily mean that the member of staff is being paid more directly. It appeared to be the flexibility that was the attraction.
Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Auditor General. Can I start by looking at Exhibit 6 on page 29? Because I think that illustrates perfectly the challenges that we're facing in our NHS. It's not a great picture. I know Colin's touched on some of the pauses in the report, and they are welcome, but we see that national performance has declined in 6 of the 8 key rating standards over the last 4 years. So we now have a situation where we only have 1 out of the 8 indicators being achieved. If nothing changes, I mean, you've said in your statement that NHS funding isn't keeping pace with increasing demand and the needs of an ageing population. If nothing changes, what could the table look like next year?
Auditors, as you will understand, are uncomfortable with speculating about what might happen, but we have highlighted very clearly in this report that both the service pressures and the financial pressures on boards are increasing, and that the solution to that is to make faster progress with the government's vision for reducing reliance on acute hospital services. The A&E 4-hour standard, for example, can be a real measure of people who simply can't receive the care they need anywhere else, whether that's an urgent GP appointment or social care that could help keep a frail older person at home safely. So investing in those services that might avoid the need for acute hospital care, we believe is the long-term solution. And as we say in the report, it's not happening fast enough to relieve the pressures you see both here in the standard performance and in the financial performance that we've reported on also.
One of the stats that concerns me most is on child and adolescent mental health services, where 5 out of the 14 territorial boards have failed to meet the 18-week children and adolescent mental health target. Why are health boards failing to keep up with demand? We know demand is increasing, and we know that the Scottish Government has made mental health a priority with an extra £150 million committed over the next 5 years. But this is still a really worrying statistic, and it's raised in the Parliament, you know, across the chamber from all parties. Why are we not getting this right in our NHS?
I completely agree with you that this is a very important service standard. I'll ask Gillian to give you a bit more detail in a moment, but just worth noting that it's another area where we're planning to do some detailed work to drill down specifically into these services. Gillian.
You've said yourself that we've got figures in the text there that the number of patients have increased as well, but it has historically been a challenging target for boards to meet, although it did improve slightly over the last year. But it's one of the specialties where there are great difficulties in recruiting staff, and there's a shortage of consultants and other staff to work in CAMHS. But as Caroline says, it's something we will be looking at in more detail next year.
I think that report will be very welcome. Another aspect in the report is that, and it's obvious to all of us, that significant health inequalities still persist. And of all the reports I've seen, I don't see any real improvement on that front. Why do you think that is the case? It's a very thorough report looking across the NHS, but why are we still failing to tackle health inequalities?
I'm sure you know better than I do that that's a very complex area, and there's both no single reason why we're not tackling it faster, and there's no single thing that would make a difference. Again, I think it's one of the really important reasons why we need to break out of this cycle of focusing on the acute health services, meeting targets for treating people in hospital, without having a picture of the whole health and social care system, and a plan for shifting more care, more provision closer to people's homes. Very often, healthcare inequality has got multiple causes. It starts very early in people's lives or even during their mother's pregnancy. And it's one of the reasons why we have highlighted in our recommendations the need for public health strategy and more emphasis on the preventive agenda, as well as making sure that the acute hospitals are playing their part in the overall system. There's no one thing that would fix it, but there is a real risk that if we keep on focusing primarily on the acute hospitals, will make that gap even more difficult to close over time.
Thank you.
Okay. Gail Ross.
Thank you, convener, and good morning. I wanted to touch on part two, the service reform, and I think we know locally and also from the government's targets for service reform, and it's brought it into sharp focus with your report, that change is necessary and the way that we provide health services has to keep evolving. We do see in the other part of the report, and I want to touch on that as well, about difficulties in recruitment and retainment of staff, especially in rural areas, and especially in NHS Highland, we're having to look at different models of staffing as well. But members of the public can be suspicious of change if they're not consulted and not kept fully informed of what is actually happening in their area. Do you have any comment on how the public are being consulted in different NHS boards? Is it working? Are the public happy? I don't want to preempt anything, but I certainly know in my area the answer to that question already. And are the staff being taken along with the service reform as well?
I think you're absolutely right about the concern there can be about changing services, and particularly changing services at a time when finances are tight, because it can very easily look like cuts rather than change. I think there's a particular difficulty with this sort of reform, because we all recognise a hospital, we know what it looks like, our parents may have died in one, our children may have been born in one, and to feel that we're losing that bit of the health service that's so visible often does feel like a loss. And I think we're not good enough often as managers in the health service, as politicians, as people with a stake in this, in painting a picture of what would replace it and how it would be better in many ways. I think there's more that could be done there. I know that a lot of effort goes into this in health boards right across Scotland, and I was interested to hear colleagues from NHS Highland last week giving evidence to the committee about not just consulting on plans, but involving people in developing plans, in taking stock of what's working now and what would work for the future. It seems to me, though, that given the scale and the pace of change we need, we almost can't do too much of that. But that's really where the attention needs to go. And it does need leadership at all levels, from the Cabinet Secretary through to the nurse on the ward whose job's going to be affected. And staff clearly need to feel they have a stake in it rather than that they're being dragged along by change that they can't influence.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. And just again to go back to page 24, where it says the NHS is facing problems recruiting and retaining staff. I mean, we've had at different levels of staffing in NHS Highland, from anaesthetists, nurses, junior doctors, consultants. In hospitals like Caithness General, we look for general surgeons and general consultants, which there seem to be less and less of as more and more of them specialise. Which is obviously good, you know, for the major hospitals and centres, but not so handy for us. So now we've got our consultants and surgeons on a rotation from Raig Mohr, which seems to be working at the moment. But I mean, it's not only NHS Highland that has this challenge. Reading through page 24 and 25, there are a lot of health boards that have problems in recruitment and retention. Why is this? Because it just seems to have come all at once. And I don't know if we've had a satisfactory explanation as to why.
In terms of the detailed answers, I think that the answer is very similar to the one I gave to Ms. Harris at the start of the session, that actually we don't know the answers. There are different stories, different views on what's happening, and that's why we're planning a detailed piece of work to look at it. I'll ask Carol to come in a moment and give you a bit more insight, because she's planning the work we'll be doing in that area. But I think it's worth also noting that we know that for the future we will need different types of jobs. In an area like the Highlands, a GP will need to play a different role from the role they play in the deep end practices in Glasgow, and that will affect the other members of the primary care team and people who work in hospitals. And again, that's why we think a workforce plan about not just what, how many and what types of staff we need, but how we really get those skills in place. Carol, do you want to add to that?
As Caroline says, it's an issue of changing roles and responsibilities to deliver different models of health and social care, and we don't have a work plan, a national work plan at this stage, that we can look at that and identify what the skills capacity will be to deliver a changed health service. We are going to be doing a piece of work this year, in fact we've already started it, to try and unpick some of the issues around retention and recruitment of staff. But it will be about looking at what we need to deliver as a health service and then working backwards. The lead-in times to train GPs and nurses means that we can't change this very quickly. So we need to look forward to identify what we need and then work backwards to try and change what's coming through in terms of trainees and so on.
Just one more, convener, if that's okay. Yeah. Just to lead on from that. We talk about shifting the balance of care from acute services to more community-based services, and I just, it's possibly not a question that you can answer, but just to get it on the record, are our care at home and community care services ready for such a huge shift? And if not, what do we have to do to ensure that they are?
I think the short answer is that first of all, as we found in our work, there are some great examples of new types of care that are not just providing traditional care in people's homes, but really working upstream to identify older people particularly, but other people who need particular support to keep them safe, to keep them living full lives at home, and to put that around them. And we reported in that in our March report on changing models of health and social care. But there aren't enough of them. They're not developing fast enough to make a difference across Scotland. And the second is that one of the things that's slowing down the growth of those services is the need to keep on meeting the demand that does turn up at the door of the acute hospital because those services aren't there. And there's a real risk that that's a sort of vicious circle. So what's needed, I think, is a plan that helps us to break out of it, to identify how you can invest enough in community-based, homely-based services that will break that cycle of rising demand on the acute hospitals and then build the services that are needed right across Scotland. There are some real beacons of light out there, but they're too isolated to make a difference to the acute hospital so far.
Okay, thank you. Excuse me.
Okay.
We need a doctor.
Liam Kerr.
Just a couple of questions. The first, just something I wanted to check out. On page 15 of your report, at paragraph 28, you just mentioned that NHS Shetland was unable to locate over 4% of its assets in its fixed asset register, which I find rather concerning. Is that something that's unique to NHS Shetland, or is that across the estate?
This was a particular problem in NHS Shetland, and what the auditor concluded was that the assets had been recorded properly when they were first acquired, but then as they were disposed of or taken out of service, they weren't written off appropriately, and the board has now undertaken to make sure its asset register is both up to date and it's kept up to date for the future. It's quite an unusual problem for us to find in the health service.
Right, so you can be confident that it's unique. So really it's just a wrap-up question that I have in terms of, you've provided a number of recommendations at pages 6 and 7, and you mentioned earlier on you're uncomfortable speculating, I understand why, but you do make some very important recommendations. Now, let's assume that all of those recommendations are taken on board and implemented. Is that a solution?
There is a great deal of consensus, not just in Scotland, but more widely, that the Scottish Government's vision to provide more care in homely settings or in people's homes is the right one and is the solution not just to the financial pressures, but also to providing all of us with better care as the population ages. The reason I think a plan is needed for implementing that vision is firstly that it's not happening fast enough, and secondly that nobody is clear actually how much investment is needed where to bring it about. The Cabinet Secretary in her statement yesterday committed to producing a plan by the end of this year, and we'll be looking closely to see how far it does pick up the funding implications, the staffing implications and the public engagement questions that Ms. Ross raised, to make sure that it can have the desired effect. Nobody has a better plan than the overall vision. The question is one of now turning it into reality.
Yes. And are you able to speculate about, you do mention that talk at page 36 of your report, about this shift, this idea of a shift in the balance of care has been in play for some considerable time, but clearly hasn't happened yet. Are you able to say why? What is, if all of the stakeholders are saying this needs to happen and this is a solution, why hasn't it happened for the best part of 11 years?
I think it probably comes down to a couple of things. One, the acute services have no option but to respond to demand when it appears as an A&E attendant, somebody who needs an urgent emergency medical admission, that means they can't stay at home anymore. And we have been in a position, almost a vicious circle, where because there weren't sufficient of the right services in the community near people's homes, more people have been admitted to hospital. We've done the analysis that shows the trends in that, particularly with an ageing population. And in turn, that reduces the resource that's available to invest in the services that would avoid that happening in the first place. So what we think is needed is that plan to really break out of that cycle, make sure we know where the investment is needed, in terms of both the sorts of buildings and services that are required, the staff that are required, GPs, community nurses, and then much closer working between community services and the hospitals. The integration authorities should play a significant role in that. They just came into effect on the 1st of April this year. It's still early days. We know some of them are still struggling with agreeing their budgets and their strategic plans. What we're recommending in this report is really a boost to make sure that the aspirations that are in place become a reality quickly enough to make a difference to the pressures that we're seeing here across Scotland's health boards.
Alex Neil.
Can I start with staffing? Because obviously this is both an immediate issue and certain some of the areas of pressure that you've referred to, both geographically and in terms of the specialism. But there's also a big strategic issue about how we solve this. I mean, it's estimated that across the world in the next 15 years, we will need to recruit an additional 70,000 doctors. So this is an international labour market we're talking about in a lot of cases. When Paul Gray was here, the chief executive of the National Health Service, he said, and it was a very welcome development, that an additional 100 training places were going to be made available for entrance into medical school. But in terms of the projected demand for services, and taking into account the fact we are operating in a competitive international labour market, is 100 anywhere near enough?
I don't think it's possible to answer that question in isolation. The question of how many staff we need, of what sort, with what skills, I think is something that absolutely the government needs to set out as part of this plan for how we achieve this. And I think staffing is one of the big challenges. We know that with an ageing population, there will be fewer people of working age available to provide not just to be doctors, but to work in nursing and social care, and all of the things that are needed to make this work. It's possible that our exit from the European Union will make that more difficult, depending on what happens with migration across borders. There are things operating on the other side of the equation with new technology, for example, making some things possible that weren't in the past, consultations by Skype being an interesting innovation in some parts of the Highlands, and also the whole agenda of community empowerment. Can we think again about how communities can take more responsibility for looking after members, and how each of us ourselves individually can do. It's all of that detail, I think, that we'd like to see in the workforce plan that helps us say whether 100 doctors is a useful contribution or if actually it's what's needed to deliver the vision.
And we hope to get that fairly soon.
the Cabinet Secretary committed yesterday to producing it by the end of this year.
Yes. So related to that, I mean, ever since the National Health Service was created, the BMA has always been resistant to significantly increasing the number of trainees being recruited to medical school because, quote, we don't want any unemployed doctors. It's just one of the restrictive practices the BMA has practiced for the last 60 years. Is it not time we actually looked at some of these restrictive practices and also at the productivity of some of our specialisms? Let me give you an example. In NHS Lanarkshire, one of the reasons for redesigning orthopaedic services has been that an orthopaedic surgeon to be operating safely should do a minimum of 35 procedures a year, and apparently some are doing as few as five. Now, they may well be doing other things, but is it not time that we look to the productivity of some of these consultants to see if we're getting value for money? Because what's happening is that if they're not performing during the week, they're then employed for the weekend on triple time, which is a bit of a bonanza financially for them, but is very costly to the health service, or we end up with patients having to go to the private sector in order to meet the waiting, their own waiting time requirement. So is it not time we really drill down into this kind of area and, you know, see if we're getting value for money?
You will know better than I, Mr. Neil, that the Scottish Government has produced a couple of reviews over the last 15 years looking at the way acute hospital services should be provided for the future. I think the first report goes back to about 2005, and there was then a review of that and a refresh of it a bit later on. And it's very clear that the evidence is that we need to look again at more in the way of regional centres for some specialist procedures, thinking about the role of acute hospitals to make sure they're both safe and efficient, and productivity is a key part of that. It's very much, I think, part of the answer of how we make sure that hospital services are as high quality and efficient as they can be for patients, and that they are only dealing with the patients who need that type of care, that we have resources that we can reinvest in services for people who actually could stay very happily and safely at home with more support from a good community team around them. So that the groundwork is there. Again, I think what's needed is that planning for turning it into a reality. That's not to say it's easy, but I think it is increasingly important.
My understanding is that there has been a review of productivity in the National Health Service in Scotland carried out internally. Have you seen that report?
I haven't seen it, and I think that would be a question for
I think
government.
We should see it. We should ask for a copy of it, because I think productivity is an extremely important element in all of this. And, you know, as I say, there's quite a lot of restrictive practices that inhibit our ability to rise to some of these challenges, particularly in the shorter term. Can I just come back also to the drugs issue? One of the exercises we did when I was Health Secretary is we compared the drugs, the use of drugs in each health board and we, you know, against each other. And comparing light with light, we reckoned if every health board, if every one of the 14 territorial health boards was as efficient at managing its drugs bill as the best one, at that time, we could have saved over £100 million a year. Is it not time we revisited that exercise and actually took the necessary action, given these figures, to make sure that we get a far, far better return on our money for the drugs bill?
It's clear that making best use of the drugs bill is a really important part of helping the health service meet the pressures it's facing, simply given the amount of money we spend on drugs and the rate at which it's increasing. The figure you've touched on there, I think, is very much in line with the figures that came out of our reviews of prescribing in previous years. We say in the report that the Scottish Government has established with health boards a task force which is looking at four areas of efficiency, and drug costs is one of them, I think. It may be something you'd like to explore further with civil servants to understand more about the approach they're taking and what they expect the benefits to be.
If you can save anything like £100 million a year, that's a very significant saving that can be redirected to other frontline services. Okay. And just finally, in terms of the overall delivery plan, can I ask, it's not a delivery plan, it's a delivery framework that we're getting by Christmas, apparently. Can I ask you, as Auditor General for Scotland, what do you expect to see in terms of that delivery framework? Are you looking for a business plan? Are you looking for an operating plan? Are you looking for a 5 or a 10 year framework? Are you looking to bring the whole thing together, the staffing, the technology, the funding and all the rest of it? What are you looking for that delivery framework to do?
Try to be as clear as we can in the report about what we think is needed. And I think there are three areas to that. The first of all is a financial plan, which contains the sort of financial modelling we've been talking about, and a funding plan if there are gaps for how we get from here to where we need to be. The second is a clear workforce plan about the numbers and the skills of staff we need, and how we in the long term train those people, and how we manage any gaps that exist in the short term. And the third is the plan for engagement with people across Scotland about why this matters, and how they will be involved in shaping services for their local area. They seem to me the three key things that need to be covered for the plan to have the effect that we think is needed.
Okay, thank you.
Alison Harris.
Yes, I just want to come in, Auditor General, on something that Alex said, you know, regarding the BMA and restrictive practices. I think there's more involved here, because if you go back 30 years when doctors were training, there was fierce competition to go from the trainee level when you became GMC registered to get into specialist training. And it was quite acknowledged amongst the generation of doctors that are now near a retirement age that that was the position. Something must have happened to change that, because in their day, you know, they can actually recount to you the competition. It was horrific to try and get into specialist training, whereas now they're scouting around begging for people to come in and train. So there's something more than just the kind of restrictive side of the BMA, and I'm not condoning the BMA in any shape or form. And that's where, you know, I was discussing earlier, I think we need to look at what's gone wrong at that little chink. Something has happened that switched that in a 30-year period from great demand of doctors to now we're scouting around for them. I don't understand it at all myself. But
I think that those sorts of questions are very much why we're planning our new audit on workforce planning. I would say, though, that it's very clear that we can't do this without doctors, without nurses being part of it. There may be some historical anomalies that need to be ironed out of the system. Equally, I think there are more opportunities, particularly for GPs, to work as partners in the health service rather than as contractors to it. And I know the Scottish Government is thinking hard about the negotiation of the new GP contract to bring GPs very much to becoming a central part of this transformation that we all want to see.
Okay, thank you.
Auditor General, I'd like to understand a little bit more about non-recurring savings. The Exhibit 2 and Exhibit 7, if you don't mind, I'll use NHS Tayside as an example. I know we're coming on to the report on that later. But Exhibit 2 says that, if I understand it correctly, that 60% of the plan savings are non-recurring. Now, my understanding of non-recurring savings is perhaps the sale of a one-off asset, and in NHS Tayside they are selling off property. I suppose my question is, and what I need you to help me understand, is if these are non-recurring savings, like one-off, why aren't recurring savings happening at the same time as non-recurring savings? Why is that percentage so high?
I'll try and keep it general in this case, because I know you will want to explore the Section 22 report on NHS Tayside in more detail later this morning. You're right, non-recurring savings include things like the sale of property and other assets. Also, short-term delays to things like filling vacancies. So if a member of staff leaves rather than filling the post immediately, a board might keep it vacant for a while and take the saving that comes from that period if they feel they can do that without affecting the quality of service and the safety of service provided to patients. They're all things that can help in the short term to close a funding gap, but they clearly don't do very much at all to make the board's financial position more sustainable for the longer term. You'll see across both exhibits there's quite a significant variation between them in how much they're relying on recurring and non-recurring savings. One of the things we found this year and in previous years is that boards often plan a higher level of recurring savings than they're able to achieve. They expect to be able to redesign a service to provide the same service at a lower cost, but actually either it takes them longer to do that or the savings don't meet the level that they expected, and they fill the gap in their budget with a non-recurring saving. Now, we have a concern about that. It's not sustainable, and it focuses a lot of effort on short-term financial management rather than the long-term planning that's needed for this issue.
So If there is a disparity between recurring savings and disparity between the board's success, all the 14 board's successes at making recurring savings, what is the reason for that disparity?
It varies between boards, as you would expect. I'll leap ahead very slightly to NHS Tayside. We've reported in the Section 22 report in front of you that analysis suggests their operating model is more expensive than that of many other boards, and that so far they haven't been as successful as they had planned to be in producing efficiencies that would bring their costs down and close the funding gap at the same time. Other boards have made more progress in redesigning services and taking other approaches that help them to bring the revenue they receive from the Scottish Government in line with their expenditure in each financial year. But the reasons are different in every health board. Gillian, do you want to add to that?
I don't think there's anything else to add.
I mean, could you say it's an issue of management and planning and strategy and all of these things?
I think it's an element of all of that, and it also, in many cases, reflects the starting point, the position that each board is in. Some boards had more generous funding historically than others and found it easier to make recurring savings. Some had models of service that had recently been reviewed, and therefore there wasn't as much sort of space or headroom for them to generate savings. There's a whole range of different reasons across different boards, and at the same time, you're right, the approach people take, the effectiveness with which they involve staff in thinking about better ways of providing services, the scrutiny and support that the board provides in making sure that plans are realistic and are being carried out as planned, all play a part.
As an auditor, how comfortable are you with the percentage, like 60%, that is non-recurring savings?
In broad terms, I think it's too high. I think that what we are looking for is not just an annual budget, but a medium-term financial plan covering 5 years or so that is very clear about the likely levels of revenue from the government and expenditure, and has got detailed plans for closing that gap in ways that are sustainable.
I'd like to ask you a general question about agency costs. We've already touched this morning on problems with recruitment and retention. What else could the health boards be doing to prevent spend on agencies?
Focusing specifically on agencies, I think one of the things which is very important for both cost and quality reasons is to minimise the use of agency staff in favour of a bank that is managed and owned by the health board itself. In response to Mr. Beattie's question, I said that often it's the flexibility that's attractive to staff rather than the fact they're being paid more. And most health boards now do have a bank where particularly nursing staff, but also medical staff in smaller numbers, can register as being available for temporary work, for ad hoc shifts, for filling gaps as they occur. They're generally paid on the standard NHS terms and conditions, so the cost is lower, and they know the system. They can be trained and inducted, and they know the way things work, so it's better in every respect than having to turn to an agency. Now, because of the nature of the health service, there are some occasions when most boards will have to turn to agencies, but I think the challenge really is to minimise the reliance on agency staff, invest in their own bank, and of course do the work of making sure that their own workforce is fully up to capacity and planned for the longer term.
Can I turn back to something you said about prevention briefly earlier on? It's an agenda I sympathise with. We launched a cross-party group on the preventative agenda for non-communicable diseases last night here in Parliament. I know you've tried to tackle this before, but is there a real way to audit prevention and its impact on the health service?
It is a great question, and there's no easy answer to it. I would say actually that it's not just about the health service, that lots of the things the health service end up having to deal with are things that come from children's very early years, from poverty, from poor quality housing, rather than just health or even health and social care services. In many ways, it's why we focus on what the government is trying to achieve in relation to its outcomes in the National Performance Framework, in all of the money it spends, the budget process, and the services that it provides. So we try to take that look back upstream and see how far things are joined up. But it is very difficult to audit everything all at once, and that's why we tend to take slices of it in the way that we do.
You maybe can't answer this, but do you think it's perhaps been one of the reasons we haven't seen so much of a resource shift to prevention, not just in the health service, but across other services, because it is very difficult to audit and create results on?
I think it's not because it's difficult to audit, but because it's difficult to do. For two reasons. One, it's genuinely a difficult thing. If you're saying we want to make Scotland a country where everybody has the chance to flourish, we do need to be thinking in a very holistic way about healthcare, education, early years, justice, housing, and be thinking about how all of those develop. I think the new social security powers provide another dimension to that needs thinking about. And more generally, we've reported in a number of instances about what we see as a gap sometimes between the outcome the government wants to achieve and the detailed plans it has for its services. It's not clear how one relates to the other. And it's filling that gap that we think would make the national performance framework and the outcomes approach more productive again in terms of really changing people's life chances over time and tackling some of the problems we see in health and social care, in justice, in education.
Thank you all very much indeed for your evidence on this report. We now move to item 3, and I'll just allow the witnesses to change over. Item 3 is our evidence session on the AGS report entitled NHS 24 Update on Management of an IT Contract. And the Auditor General is now joined by Carol Calder, Senior Manager for Audit Scotland, and Nick Bennett, partner of Scott Moncrief. The Auditor General will make an opening statement before I open up to questions.
Thank you, Convener. I'm bringing two further reports to the committee this morning which highlight matters of public interest in NHS 24 and NHS Tayside. I've prepared these reports under Section 22 of the Public Finance and Accountability Act 2000. I'd like to highlight at the outset that in both cases the external auditors gave unqualified opinions on the accounts of the organisations. This means they're satisfied that the accounts provide a true and fair view of the body's financial position. I've prepared reports on these boards because I believe there are issues of public interest that should be brought to the attention of Parliament through this committee. I'll start with NHS 24. The report on NHS 24 provides an update on the implementation of a new IT system called the Future Programme. I reported to your predecessor committee in October 2014 and then again in November 2015 on how weaknesses in contract management had led to delays and escalating costs with this programme. In October 2015, NHS 24 attempted its planned launch of the new system. Following a serious deterioration in call handling times as NHS 24 staff struggled to use the new system, NHS 24 reverted to its existing system to protect patient safety. NHS 24 now plans full implementation by December 2017, 4.5 years after the original intended implementation date of June 2013. Last year, I reported that the total cost of the programme had risen by 55% to £117.4 million, compared to an outline business case cost of £75.8 million. NHS 24 now estimates that the total cost of the programme will be £131.2 million, 73% above that in the original business case, mainly as a result of additional double running costs. The Scottish Government has provided additional loan funding of £20.75 million to NHS 24 over the period from 2012-13 to 2014-15 to help it manage these additional costs. Of this brokerage, £20.35 million is still outstanding. Over the last 9 months, under the leadership of its new chief executive, NHS 24 has undertaken a fundamental look at what needs to be done to fully implement the new system. While significant challenges do remain, I believe the board is now taking reasonable steps to reduce the risk of further delay. I'm joined, as you say, by Nick Bennett from Scott Moncrief, who I appoint as the auditor of NHS 24, and between us we'll do our best to answer the committee's questions.
Thank you very much. Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener. General, I accept what you say here, that as far as patients are concerned, this hasn't impacted on them. But this is an ongoing story which we've seen repeated in front of this committee in various IT projects that have been managed or mismanaged, and this one's clearly been mismanaged. And I'm looking at the report here on page 7, looking at paragraph 22 and 23, and I would ask for your comments as to, does this not seem like overkill? Suddenly, we have a problem with the contract, so let's form umpteen management groups and so on to oversee it and presumably trip over each other. I mean, when I was in the private sector, at some point I had an IT division reporting to me. I couldn't imagine working through this sort of complexity. What's your take on that?
I'll ask Nick to comment in a moment. My view actually is that most of this is almost certainly required. The review that was undertaken by the new chief executive when she took up post highlighted, as we say in the report, that some of the failings came from a failure to have engaged with the people in health boards who need to join up services with what NHS 24 does. And I think a great deal of the new architecture that you've highlighted here in paragraph 22 is about making sure that those relationships are in place and are working effectively. Nick's closer to it, and I think he may have a perspective that you'd find useful as well.
Yes, I'd just like to agree with the Auditor General there. I think the groups that have been set up do provide the scrutiny and challenge that is required on this project. They have highly experienced senior individuals within those groups, and they have a sign-off process involved in any subsequent phase development of this project. So I think they're certainly a useful development in the governance.
Are they not compensation for the fact that we don't appear to have people of the right skills to manage this, therefore, you know, form a committee?
Well, I think in the past we have commented on the lack of available skills within NHS 24, and I think what the board have done in response to that is to bring in experts from outside the board to act in this scrutiny and challenge approach.
So are we paying money to bring in people from outside to sit on these groups?
No, these are all internal to the NHS or the wider public sector bodies. So, you know, they are highly experienced senior individuals, but they are all within the public sector.
Okay. Just obviously one of the big concerns is the financial obligations in this. And under financial implications, it's saying that it's unlikely that any of the additional costs can be recovered. Do we have a feel for what the total of the additional costs are going to be over the period?
I think that NHS 24 are confident that they can deliver what's required within the figure that's included in my report here. And a significant amount of that does relate to double running costs of implementing the new system while keeping the old one up and running. Clearly, there may be change over time, but this is the latest estimate from NHS 24, their projection of what the project will cost, and in my view is based on a more thorough understanding of what's required than has been the case in my previous reports.
So the reference here to additional costs is purely about the double running, not about any other.
We've tried to break that down in Exhibit 1, where we compare the original business case, the projected costs from last October, and the projected costs from June from NHS 24. And you'll see that most of the increase has been in the implementation costs, which include the double running costs that have gone up by £39.1 million. 132% of the original estimate. The ongoing support costs for the contract itself have gone up, but by a much smaller relative amount.
I suppose there's two things to this. Firstly, you seem to be confident that now they have a grip of the project and that it'll be delivered in the timescales and within the budget that they've indicated. Would that be correct?
I'm much more confident now that the board understands the scale of what needs to be done and has put in place appropriate mechanisms for it. It's for the board itself to provide assurance and deliver that, but I feel more comfortable now than I did a year ago about the prospects for the project, certainly.
I mean, clearly there's a bigger issue here, which hopefully this committee will address in due course. Thank you.
Liam Kerr.
Thank you. Now, I appreciate you've dealt with or looked at this a couple of times previously, but I wasn't about, so I just want to explore initially the contractual arrangements here. So you state in the report that the arrangements were flawed, and then there's a chronology, a very useful chronology at page 12 in the Appendix B, in which we can see that the omissions in the tender document are discovered in August 2011. 2 months later, a contract is awarded. 6 months later, NHS 24 staff identify things are missing, and 2 years later, it's reported to those in charge. Now, who is responsible for that? That, to me, is an enormous failure. Who was found to be responsible, and what were the consequences?
You're right, it's a very significant failure, and it was of serious concern to your predecessor committee. None of us likes to see an IT system getting out of control, but for the audit work and the inquiries to have uncovered that actually a member of staff was aware of omissions in the contract documentation that weren't brought to the attention of the chief executive until much later on is a serious failure of governance and accountability. Nick will keep me straight on this, but there have been significant departures of staff from the chief exec down from people who were originally responsible for this, and I think NHS 24 is now in the final stages of appointing a new permanent chief executive who's been involved in turning the project around, who will be accountable for taking it forward from here. Nick, do you want to add to that?
Yes, that's correct. A new chief executive has been appointed. Basically, most of the senior management who were involved in the original procurement of the future programme have now left the organisation, as indeed most of the non-executive directors have changed as well.
which is all encouraging, but we're now running under various letters of intent, and contractual documents are not due to be signed until December, and that contractual review has been running since January 2015. What's your view on that? Is that good business to be running the whole project along, changing the senior management whilst we don't even have contracts in place?
It is an area of risk, for sure, and I know the board are trying to finalise these contracts. The new contracts have been sent to Capgemini and to BT, and negotiations are ongoing about finalising these direct contracts. But it is an important it's an important area that needs to be finalised pretty quickly.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned that a final cost will only be available at launch. So, as at this stage, so this was paragraph 27, a definitive cost for implementing system is only available once launched and operating successfully. Are you comfortable with that as auditors?
I think because this whole project really has been beset by problems and delays, we're not going to know that final implementation is in accordance with the timetable that's laid out until it actually happens. And given that a lot of the costs are double running costs of the existing system at the same time, the final cost is not going to be known until the new system actually goes live successfully.
Which is extraordinary. But the total projected cost, you've said, is 131 million.
Yes.
Do you have any idea? I appreciate this is a complex system. But it can't be a unique system. I mean, fundamentally, things look like each other. Do you not have any idea, or is there any way to establish what an equivalent cost would be in the private sector? If the private sector was commissioning a similar system to do something similar to what this is supposed to do, what would be the cost of that, do you think? Has that comparison been done?
Not as far as I know. I mean, the outline business case was originally for 75 million. Mm-hmm. But the new system, to be fair, has progressed quite significantly since that outline business case. And one of our recommendations is that a business case be prepared on what the new system actually delivers, not only what it costs, but what are the benefits. And once that business case has been prepared, I think the board will be in a better position to answer that particular question.
Yes. And that must be a good recommendation to prepare the business case. But meanwhile, I go back to the contracts are still being negotiated, the systems are still being progressed in the absence of that business case. At what point does it become a good idea for NHS 24 to step back, hit pause and say, look, this hasn't worked, let's just take a step back and review what's going on, review what we need it to look like, rather than trying to negotiate in the background and run the system along?
Yes, we did report to the last committee that there had been a detailed review of whether they should progress with this system. At the last time the system failed to go live, there was a deep dive review about whether they should abandon the existing system, but that concluded that they should continue to develop the system that they were working on.
Right. And just one final thing. This isn't the first time that this committee has looked at this, and it isn't the first time this committee's looked at IT projects. So do you have any idea who's taking the macro learning from this? Do you see any evidence that that all these various IT projects that are in significant trouble, that is being acknowledged and something and being future-proofed for future IT?
You're absolutely right that this is sadly not an isolated incident, and I have reported a couple of times on the bigger picture for developing major IT systems in the public sector. The government has made some changes. It's appointed a chief information officer. It has plans in place to develop capacity within government itself that can support smaller bodies like NHS 24 when they're making large investments in IT. We've also made some recommendations about the importance of really focusing effort at the very beginning of the project, being clear what it is you intend to achieve, what the right contract structure is, and how you will know that progress is being made well. The committee has taken evidence on that overall strategy a couple of times. I think it's too soon to be clear that it's having the desired effect, but it has to be the right approach to really invest in a central core of expertise at the right level to be able to do this, and to make sure that bodies don't start off projects like this without the right expertise, understanding, IT skills, legal skills, to make it work. I hope we won't see this again. It's too soon to say the changes the government has made will deliver that.
Thank you.
Alex Neil.
I really have just two questions. The first one is the outstanding loan of over £20 million that NHS 24 has to repay to the government. Now, obviously, that's on top of the normal requirements for efficiency savings, etc. So, and I appreciate it has been extended to a longer period of time, but if you take £20 million out of an organisation like this, that's not an insignificant amount of money. So what other services are going to be cut back to pay the £20 million from NHS 24 to the Scottish Government? Because something has to give. And my second question is, given that this project has now been running for 4 or 5 years, and the whole point was to introduce new leading-edge technology, and given the pace at which technology changes, is this technology now leading-edge? Is it up to date? Is it what's going to be the product life cycle of this technology, given that it's 5 years beyond the date when it should have gone live?
I'll start off by saying that obviously repaying £20 million to the government would be very significant for a board of this size, and it's worth noting that the revised repayment plan has been agreed between the board and the government. Nick may be able to add more detail about where the board intends to make savings to deliver that, or it may be a question that should be directed to NHS 24.
I think inevitably savings will be required in order to repay the brokerage and the additional costs that will be required going forward, and a number of the initiatives that had previously been planned have had to be put back. I think in terms of other savings that the board has to make, it's probably best addressed to the health board themselves.
You should write to them and ask them those questions.
In terms of the technology, one of the reasons asking for a full business case actually is to is to identify the changes that have actually taken place to the original future programme and what benefits that can be brought that were not envisaged at the time that the original business case was drafted, because there have been quite significant changes to the technology over this period.
So will this technology be fit for purpose, and if so, for how long?
I think that's another question for the board.
Well, you're the auditor, so surely you've got a view on that?
We'd like to see the full business case prepared, because that will identify what the benefits are that are coming to the board over the next 10 years.
Okay, I think we should take that with the board as well.
Can I ask, has the total cost of the future programme changed since the AGS report was published?
No, the board is projecting £131.2 million as of June this year, I think, and there's been no change to that we're aware of.
And the estimated total cost is now £55.4 million higher than the envisaged in the business case, and the Scottish Government has loaned the £20 million as discussed. Does this mean there's a deficit of £34.7 million? And have the auditors discussed how this could be met?
The cost between the £20.35 million provided in brokerage and the £55 million total have been and will be met by the board itself from its overall budget during that period. As Nick said, that's meant delaying some projects that they plan to undertake and making efficiency savings elsewhere. But the board hasn't run a deficit with the brokerage available from government. It's hit its financial targets.
Okay.
Worth pointing out that the £131.2 million includes £62.5 million for ongoing support costs, which are in effect the support costs over the 10-year period. Hence, so you know, these are costs that not have been incurred yet, but will be incurred.
Thank you very much. I'm going to suspend for 5 minutes before the next item and for a comfort break. Thank you. We now move to item number 4 on the agenda, which is our evidence session on the AGS report entitled The 2015-16 Audit of NHS Tayside Financial Sustainability. And the Auditor General is joined by Carol Calder, Senior Manager of Audit Scotland, and Kenny Wilson, a partner at PricewaterhouseCoopers. The Auditor General again will make an opening statement before I open up to questions.
Thank you, Convener. As we discussed earlier, the NHS is under increasing financial pressure for a range of reasons. I prepared a report for the Committee on NHS Tayside last year, which highlighted its reliance on brokerage from the Scottish Government to meet overspends, difficulties in achieving its planned savings, and delays in selling surplus property. This year's report highlights my continuing concerns about the financial sustainability of the board. In 2015-16, NHS Tayside received a total of £5 million in brokerage from the Scottish Government to enable it to break even. The board has now received a total of £24.3 million in brokerage over the last 4 years, of which it's been able to repay £4.3 million. NHS Tayside did not repay any brokerage during 2015-16, and it doesn't anticipate that it will be able to repay any of the outstanding £20 million in 2016-17. It is currently discussing a revised repayment plan with the government. In addition to this commitment to repay brokerage, the board is projecting a potential deficit of £11.65 million for 2016-17, and it needs to make efficiency savings of £58.4 million in the same year. Overall, I've concluded that there is a significant risk that the board will not achieve its financial plan for 2016-17 and future years. I'm joined here by Kenny Wilson from PricewaterhouseCoopers, who I appoint as the external auditor for NHS Tayside, and again, we'll do our best to answer the committee's questions.
Thank you very much, Auditor General. Alex Neil is going to open questioning.
Auditor General, am I right in saying then that NHS Tayside owes the Scottish Government £20 million. It has £58 million of savings to make, and it's projected this year to make a deficit of £11 million. How on earth is it going to achieve any of that?
It is in discussion with the Scottish Government about its financial position. Our expectation is that it will agree a revised repayment plan for the brokerage that's outstanding and likely additional support for the current year. But that's very much why this report is here, because I have concerns about financial sustainability with that widening gap.
So basically, if it's got to repay the existing £20 million plus, and it has a deficit this year of £11 million, which has to be funded by the Scottish Government, presumably again through brokerage loan, so there's over £30 million. Where is it going to find £30 million to repay the Scottish Government and at the same time make £58 million of savings? That's a huge reduction in service provision. Surely that's totally unachievable and unsustainable.
I'll ask Kenny to comment in a moment, but I think that really is a question for the board. The reason for reporting here to the committee is that I have a concern that its financial position increasingly doesn't look sustainable. Kenny, yeah. Would you like to add to that?
Yes, it's certainly they've put in place a 5-year transformation plan where they hope to aim to make savings of £175 million over that five-year period. But there is no doubt that this year, in 16-17, £58 million of savings is required to achieve financial balance. And that is quite significantly more than they've saved in previous years. So it will be a challenge for them. I think what is worth, though, saying is that Tayside has a number of things that would give them good opportunity to make those savings through a redesign of their whole service. And they're certainly well, the board have certainly embraced that. They have a higher average patient cost than other boards. They have higher prescribing costs than other boards. They also have a number of over 26 hospital estates and also one of the largest property footprints across against compared to other boards. They have an old over 60% of their properties over 30 years, and therefore, compared to other boards, also are older. So there are a number of things that they can do that will take time, but over they are planning to make in their 5-year transformation to make those savings. So the board have an ambitious plan, but have a working through that plan to try and achieve that.
But as you know, redesign of services takes a long time. I don't know the detail of Tayside's proposals on redesign, but you know, presumably any significant redesign in order to facilitate the repayment of this amount of money is going to be a big redesign, and a big redesign is going to take years. And we've already seen one of their failures is their failure to dispose of assets on anything like the scale required so far. So surely it's very optimistic to assume that they're suddenly going to be able to dispose of these assets on the scale required, not to make very deep cuts in service provision. Surely, you know, as auditors, you must recognise that this... we can't just say to patients in Tayside, because of the incompetence of your board, we're going to hammer you in terms of service cuts. I mean, it's just not sustainable. In terms of the risk in this, it seems to me this, you know, if this was in the private sector, it'd be a basket case.
We're absolutely not saying that what needs to happen is that services are cut to fund the gap that I've highlighted. The reason for bringing the report to the committee's attention is so that the committee and the parliament are aware of the challenges here, and so that you have the opportunity to explore with the board and with government how they plan to address that problem.
I think we need to talk to both the government and the board on this, because this worries me about the potential impact on service provision in Tayside, which sounds to me as though what's being proposed is unacceptable in terms of service cuts that would need required to pay for the incompetence of the board. My next question is, you know, given the level of incompetence, I mean, in your own report, you're talking about the enhancements during leave. If you read paragraph 12 to 16, it's clearly a story of management incompetence. Obviously an element. I'm not suggesting that's the only factor, because we'd all know the pressures in the National Health Service. But clearly, things have not been managed very well in Tayside. Can I ask, has there been any head role? Has anybody been, you know, hauled over the coals for this? I mean, this is really rank bad management by people who are paid extremely well.
No, I'm not aware of anyone being held to account on that or lost their job in the terms of...
So nobody's been held to account for this mess?
I think the board recognise the challenges they have and have taken them on board and are discussing quite regularly with Scottish Government and how they can address these challenges. But no one, as I'm aware, has been held to account for anything that's happened in the past.
And do you not think that sends out the wrong message to everybody in the health service? You know, if people in senior positions, we're not talking probably about medics here, we're talking about managers, holding down senior positions, very well paid positions, and yet they're delivering this kind of performance, surely something has to happen.
Yes, I think something should happen. I think, though, action is being taken, which is encouraging to address some of the concerns and address the challenges they are facing.
But do you have any competence on the existing management team to take the necessary action when they've got the board into the mess it's in?
I think if you look at the current management, they've been in place recently put in place, so the chief executive's only been in for the last couple of years, and along with the director of finance, the two key executives who are making big changes in the transformation plan. So I think that there are hard steps being changed with the new management in place, that progress will be made.
Well, I wish I was as confident as you, and I think we need to invite in both the board and the government, Paul Gray, on this, because this is, I just don't see how you're going to be able to get anywhere near the requirement in terms of reaping the money, making the savings, without very, very deep cuts in service provision, which I would have thought would be unacceptable to the patients in Tayside.
Completely agree that this is a very serious situation. The powers that we've got are to report here to the Public Audit and Post-Legislative Scrutiny Committee about it, so that you're aware of it and can explore with Government and Tayside what action they're taking.
Okay.
Mr. Wilson, how appropriate are pay enhancements for senior managers given the state of NHS Tayside finances?
Well, there's certainly something that's been in place, not just in Tayside, but right across other boards. So they are in line with other boards. I think that it's a practice that's been there for a number of years, and therefore it'd be up to discussion with Scottish Government whether that those pay terms were amended.
So it's very much within the hands of the Scottish Government whether these pay enhancements are awarded.
Certainly something that is part of the packages that are given reward of staff, and therefore I guess it's just like any other aspect of reward that they can be adjusted and through negotiation with staff.
In your audit, did you reach a figure on what these pay enhancements totaled to over the last year?
Yes, the cost, the annual cost of pay enhancements, let me just have a check with the... There's two elements of the pay enhancements in Tayside. There's the one-off catch-up to catch up the error that was made in prior years. And that totals a provision of close to £10 million.
Sorry, to clarify, I'm talking about senior management's managers rather than the the enhancements programme that's been ongoing.
Right. So, could you clarify? So it's the enhancements to senior management's...
To senior managers, yes. There's awards made very recently that were significantly above 1%. I wondered if you had totaled those during your audit.
I haven't got that number to hand, but I can certainly provide that to the committee after this meeting.
Okay, thank you. Can I ask you, you talked about the five-year transformation programme, which I'm familiar with. It was discussed at the NHS Tayside's annual review just a few weeks ago as well. You talked about redesign of the whole service, that was appropriate. I think the Auditor General said that as well. What exactly does that mean?
The executive team have put forward a work looking at six work streams across the health board, looking at all aspects of their health board. As I said, they have a number of areas where their operating cost model is operating at higher than compared to other boards. So they are looking at workforce planning. They're looking at property estate planning. So they're also looking at the realistic medicine, the way they better buy and procurement, as well as facilities and estates. So looking right across a number of areas and looking at trying to see how best they can make the service more efficient and more effective.
Could it mean a reduction in the number of jobs?
I think that, for example, there are a number of areas where it would indicate, for example, clerical and administrative staff, they have a higher proportion of staff compared to other boards, that would indicate that savings could be made if jobs were reduced without impacting, hopefully, any impact on the service.
The report talks about brokerage, and we know that NHS Tayside has had to go to the Scottish Government for the last 4 years for brokerage. Can the panel tell me, can brokerage be provided indefinitely? Could it be waived by the Scottish Government? And if it is required for Tayside possibly into next year, and that would total then 5 years, does this suggest that brokerage is not really about unexpected change to planned expenditure?
Brokerage is certainly intended to be a short-term loan which responds to unexpected expenditure, and in order to receive brokerage, a board normally has to demonstrate to the Scottish Government that it's able to repay it in future years, and a repayment plan is part of the conditions for it. In this case, it appears to me that the repayment plan has not been realistic. The health board hasn't been able to repay very much at all of the brokerage that it's received. It has no plans to repay in this year, and discussions are underway about future years. There is no reason why the Scottish Government couldn't waive brokerage if it chose to do that. I think my concern for the health service as a whole, as well as for NHS Tayside, is that what's needed is a more strategic, longer-term financial plan, which provides a realistic balance between the funding that's available and the costs of providing services. And Tayside is the health board where that gap is most apparent.
So it is quite possible that the Scottish Government, if they decide it, they could waive the debt that NHS Tayside has incurred to them over the last 4 years?
As far as I'm aware, there's no reason why they should, why they couldn't do that if they decided to do it. They would obviously have to think about the impact on NHS Tayside and on the wider health service, mm-hmm. but I think it would be at their own discretion.
I mean, given that NHS Tayside has had to go for brokerage for the last 4 years and the model is about unexpected change, clearly the debt in the future and the planned savings and all that is not unexpected. As you've identified, it is very much expected that it's going to be very difficult for them to meet their savings targets and the cuts agenda, I hope not. But, I mean, is there a different model required by the Scottish Government to meet the very difficult situation of NHS Tayside other than this brokerage model?
I'd put it again in the context of the NHS as a whole, and I think two things are needed. Members of the committee may recall that we have reported this year and in previous years on the need for a more flexible regime, which doesn't require each health board to balance both its revenue spending and its capital spending to the penny every year, because that focuses a lot of attention on this year's targets rather than long-term sustainability. And secondly, as we were discussing in relation to the overview report, that longer-term financial plan for the NHS as a whole to make sure that its finances are sustainable and that change is happening is part of the solution to this. But I completely agree that the way brokerage is being used here is not currently helping to address the underlying questions about the financial sustainability of the board.
Given this very difficult situation, would you be recommending to the Scottish Government that they need to come up with a different model to help NHS Tayside out of this situation?
Our understanding is that NHS Tayside and the government are already in discussion about the future. I don't know what those discussions are covering. It may well be an issue that the committee wants to explore with both parties.
Your report says that reliance on agency staff has risen by 39% just over the last year. Why is the figure so high?
I think one of the key things that they are looking to address is the agency work and to increase the nurse bank that they have. Certainly in 2016-17, they aim to reduce that by 30%, which is the agency costs contract agency, for non-contract agency workers, which is encouraging. I think part of the reason is making sure that they have a good nurse bank so they can draw on that and not rather than having to use agency workers. And that's one of the things they've been certainly looking to try and work at. But the reasons why they got into a position where the reliance of high agency, I'm unclear on. You'd have to ask the board.
Okay. We talked a little bit earlier about jobs, and Mr. Wilson said that, you know, due to the expensive operating model of NHS Tayside and service redesign, there would be a chance that, you know, clerical or administrative posts may be part of that redesign. I'm very concerned by that. Obviously, we don't want staff to have to bear the brunt of mismanagement, financial mismanagement at NHS Tayside. Why is their operating model so expensive?
I think, mentioned earlier, there are probably a number of factors that have impacted it. It's unclear as to the reason why things like agency costs are higher to me and prescribing are higher. So there are two reasons what certainly drive a big cost difference. But as it does come back to the number of, you have 26 hospital sites, which is a large number, that there is a need to look to consolidate some of those sites to make savings from doing that. I think and that's again the 5-year transformation plan is looking at all these options, and therefore with an old estate as well, they've got an older property estate which tends to be more inefficient. It's because of its age, it takes more to look after, more cost to look after it, and some of this estate is very low occupancy, and therefore there's an opportunity to consolidate that. So there's quite a number of factors that are contributing to their position, but that's what they're looking to try and address.
That brings me on to non-recurring savings, which we touched on in your general report. How concerned are you, Mr. Wilson, about the high percentage of non-recurring savings, given the huge amount of savings that NHS Tayside has to make this year, £60 million?
Yes, certainly. It is a good grave concern that the proportion of recurring savings is a low level. Again, I think that partly that's because to achieve the recurring savings does require some more structural change, and that does tend to take longer to put in place. But it certainly would be far more far better position if they could have a lower percentage of non-recurring savings. There's no doubt about that. Yeah.
Prescribing has been identified as one of the costs, and I know you reported on NHS Tayside last year. Can you just confirm for me, Auditor General, if prescribing was identified as a factor in your report last year as well?
I have to confess, Convener, that I can't confirm that from here. We can obviously do it immediately after the meeting.
One of my concerns is that Mr. Wilson talks about redesign of the service and much more structural change, but the initiative on prescribing was only launched about 3 weeks ago, at the most a month ago. Why haven't NHS Tayside managed to deal with these issues a lot sooner? I mean, they have been aware that prescribing has been an issue for a long time now.
That is true. I think it's probably best to ask them that question. I can't answer that.
Okay, I think my last question. On a minor point of clarification, paragraph 21 refers to an efficiency savings target for 2016-17 at an unprecedented level of 58.4 million. Is this unprecedented for Tayside or for Scotland? I think the general report, NHS in Scotland 2016 audit, suggests that Shetland's target may be slightly higher, but that might be percentage rather than
it's
total cost.
Unprecedented for Tayside. I think the Shetland savings target is just about more 7%.
Our report shows it as 8.7%, but that's obviously of a much smaller overall spend for the board.
Yes.
Still significant for Shetland, but a much smaller sum of money involved.
So in terms of efficiency saving targets in pure numbers, in hard cash, this efficiency saving target for NHS Tayside is unprecedented across Scotland.
For the information available here today, yes, it's higher than anything across Scotland in cash terms. And as Kenny said, more importantly, it's unprecedented for this board in terms of their ability to deliver savings over recent years. This is a very significant increase and clearly very challenging for them, as you and other members have highlighted.
Thank you. Alison Harris.
Well, actually, I think you've really asked everything that I was thinking about, Jenny, so I don't really have any.
Okay. Liam Kerr. Likewise. Colin Beattie.
Just a couple of things. I mean, I'd like to associate myself with the comments that Alex Neil's been made. Frankly, looking at all the financial indicators here and looking at this report, it's unfortunate that the management team did not handle this better. There's clear deficiencies here. If you look at a situation where we have higher staffing and higher costs than other NHS boards, and they can't even meet more than 5 out of 15 national targets, I mean, it would be bad enough having the extra costs and so on, but not to meet the targets as well is pretty shameful. I think that this bears a great deal more investigation. You highlight on paragraph 29 a whole series of work streams that they're putting in place to try to sort the thing out. These are all basic management things that should have been dealt with. This is not new. This is day-to-day management, and it doesn't seem to have been taking place. I'd like to just pick up on something that Kenny Wilson said. We're talking about awards to senior staff, and I think it's proper. We should just be clear. The government may set the policy in terms of these, but it's actually the local board that makes the awards. So the government is not directly involved in there in giving awards. I'd like to come back on the property side. Obviously, that's a great concern. These are one-off sales. It's not sustainable. But I remember in a previous report, Audit General, you were talking about Ashludy Hospital, and there was particular issues around that, and there's particular issues in respect to the accounting for that. Has that gone away? Has it been adjusted through the accounts? Is Ashludy still one of these properties that are waiting sale?
I'll ask Kenny to give you the up-to-date position. You're absolutely right that my previous, or one of my previous reports, raised concerns about the accounting treatment where proceeds were being recognised in advance of a sale being agreed, which is clearly, again, contrary to proper practice. Kenny?
Yes, in 14-15, we reported that we made the board adjust for the... They had recognised the sale of Ashludy and their accounts in 14-15, and that was reversed out and not recognised in that year. The sale was subsequently... It had an impact of requiring additional brokerage of, I think the number was just about £5 million in 14-15. That sale then was finalised in 15-16 and recognised in the accounts as a profit. The same sum was then recognised correctly in 15-16 as when the sale was concluded in October 2015.
So that one-off sale has reduced the brokerage, or...?
Taken into with discussion with the Scottish Government, they were allowed to take that into their revenue numbers for that year, for the 15-16 year.
The properties that are outstanding, it says here the board anticipates receipts of 7.6 million from 24 properties and sites. Seems an awful lot of properties and sites. What do they consist of? I've no feel for it. It's not very much money for that number of sites.
I think one of the challenges they face where the sites are in terms is to try and find in the current environment buyers that want to convert the sites into different use. So they have had a lot of challenges to find appropriate buyers, and they've tried to. They're trying. They've outlined that they hope to sell those sites for £7.4 million. And again, it will take time to achieve that, and to achieve the most maximum value they can maximise that value they can get.
Now, these are a fair number of properties, and presumably a substantial number must be empty,
yes,
waiting for sale. So there is a cost to maintaining them, cost to providing security and so on. So although it's a one-off benefit in selling them, do we have a feel for how much benefit there is from the revenue side in reducing those costs?
There will certainly be savings from disposing of those properties, ongoing savings, reducing...
Anything significant?
From those particular sites, I don't have a number, but I can try and find out what the number of potential savings. The majority of those sites are unoccupied and not being used currently.
But as we well know, providing security to some of these sites and keeping them... safe,
yes,
can be quite expensive.
Yes, it can be. You're right.
It'd be interesting to know what the impact on revenue potentially could be, because that, of course, would be a recurring saving.
Yes,
as opposed to a one-off.
Yeah.
My suspicion is it's not going to exactly swing them around, though.
No, but it certainly will help, yeah. And we certainly can find that number out and provide it to the committee after the meeting.
Okay.
Can I just go back briefly? Any other questions from members? Monica.
I had a question, Convener, but I think Colin Beattie's picked up some of it. It's again on this issue of assets held for sale. My sense of reading the report and hearing the evidence today is that there's quite a strong reliance on these 24 properties. But we can see in the report that, you know, the vast majority have been held for sale for quite a long time, 13 for over a year, and three of them for over 4 years. So this figure of 7.6 million, I assume, is based on projected market value. But I just wondered, what advice is the board receiving? Does the board have internal expertise? What is the marketing plan for these properties? Is it being kept under review? Because from reading the report and hearing what you've just said, I'm not convinced that this £7.6 million is achievable anytime soon, and there doesn't seem to be any other fallback. So I just wonder what you can say about the professional advice that's been
made available to the board. I'm aware that they are working closely with other skills and experts within the Scottish Government. Scottish Future Trust has been helping advise them on the disposal of sales. But I think you're absolutely right. There is it is taking longer than they would like to sell these properties. I think it will take longer than they may even anticipate. The values they've put to it are estimates that they're being told by professional people that think they can get those values. But unfortunately, only time will tell whether they can receive it. I think that it's fair to say that the values they've achieved to date on selling properties have not been as high as people have thought they might achieve and they would like to achieve. But a lot of work has been spent by the management team to understand what the properties are and try and make sure their estimates are realistic. But I think the time frame of those selling these properties is difficult to really measure. And there's obviously a trade-off between trying to maximise the value as well as trying to dispose of them in a quick way.
So have offers been made but been rejected on the basis that they're not?
I think there have been there have been a couple of properties where offers were made have now started, the management have taken the steps to accept those offers because they recognise, as Mr. Beattie says, that it is better in some respects to dispose of the properties and move forward on them. So they are working on that, but they are taking advice from the right people, I believe, to advise them on that.
So are these offers below market value?
They tend to be more, the offers are around market value, but for some of the properties and below for others. So they're just you'd probably best ask the board for an update exactly where they are with that.
Okay. So if properties were being sold on the cheap, to put it that sense, how would that be reported at the board and how do we, I suppose what I'm asking is, you know, in terms of transparency, how would we find out if, we're seeing good value and properties are not being sold off too cheaply? Mm-hmm.
It's certainly something that as part of every audit we'd look and see what you'd see the value coming through the accounts as a loss in the disposal of the properties, and you'd be able to see from the accounts on an annual basis what the impact of that is. But it's I don't believe there's a plan to try and sell them off at any lower than the market value. Unfortunately, the value they're selling them are very much at what the market's willing to pay. And it's just very difficult for them because, as I said, the property market in Dundee around the Tayside area is quite challenging.
Thank you.
Can I come back briefly to a couple of points? I want to go back to this 39% rise in agency staff because I'm just not clear about why there has been such a huge rise just over the last year. I know I've asked this question before, but can you shed any light on that?
I think that the challenge they've had is really that they've not been in the position to have the sufficient bank nurse and the right staffing. I think that it is a question you'd have best placed to ask the executive team. I know, as I said, it is an area they are very focused on to try and address. As I say, indicated they are looking to try and reduce agency costs by 30% in 16-17, and they are increasing the nurse bank quite significantly in order to reduce that. The reasons why the increase happened the previous year, I'm unclear myself as to why they got to that level.
Auditor General?
I was just checking with Carol what information we've got here now. I think it is a question you'd need to explore with the board itself. If we look at the summary information we've got in the overview report, it's very clear that the nursing and midwifery agency spending has gone up a lot. But actually, the nursing and midwifery vacancy rate isn't particularly high compared to other boards across Scotland. So I think it's a question that would be well worth exploring with the board to see what's led to that jump in the agency spending. They do target in the submission they've made to you that it's one of the key areas they wish to reduce in order to bring their finances back into balance, but they don't explain what led to the increase in the first place.
I mean, I know you looked at this in your general report that we studied earlier, and from best practice in other boards that have less reliance on agency staff. How do they achieve that, and what lessons could NHS Tayside learn from that?
There's clearly three things that play into the use of agency staff. One is having vacancies on the establishment, and it appears from the figures here that the vacancy rate isn't particularly high in NHS Tayside. The second is having high levels of sickness absence, where there's a need to fulfil that gap across the piece, because services need to continue to be delivered and a member of staff needs to come in. And the second is the way those short-term gaps are filled, whether they're filled by agencies or by the board's own nursing bank. So any of those three are possible. The figures we have here today suggest that it's not either the vacancy rate or the sickness rate, looking at the figures in the overview report. So I think it's an entirely appropriate area to explore with the health board.
So it's a matter of kind of managing the balance between bank nursing and contracted nurses.
That I would expect is one of the areas to explore. There may be other factors that are unique to Tayside that aren't coming through the submission that they've made to you. They highlight in the submission that you have that they forecast a 30% reduction equivalent to £1.5 million this year. They don't focus on why it's as high as it is in the first place.
Do you think that's achievable?
As Kenny and I have said throughout this session, we think it's challenging. Whether that specific reduction is achievable, I think, will depend on what the reasons are for the high level of spend in the first place.
Given you all think this situation is challenging, could we be looking, as Mr. Neil said, about cuts to services in NHS Tayside?
I think that very much depends on, first of all, the success with it, which Tayside is able to deliver its transformation plan, which they summarised in their submission to you, and secondly, in the support which the Scottish Government is able to give them during the period while they're implementing it. But the reason why I've reported to you today is that I'm concerned their finances are currently not sustainable and services can't carry on being delivered against this financial background.
And do you think that transformation plan is good enough at this stage?
Kenny may want to add to it. I think our sense is that it focuses on the right areas and that the board has struggled to deliver its efficiency savings in the past. Mm. Kenny?
Yeah, I think I agree with Caroline that it will be a very challenging 5 years. I think the five-year plan is focusing on the correct areas they need to focus on. It's clear that there are circumstances unique to Tayside that does lend itself the opportunity to make some significant improvements, and both in its efficiency and effectiveness, which is good. But I think there's no doubt that it is still will be quite a challenge to implement and make those savings, £175 million over that five-year period of time, and to repay the brokerage. And I think, as we said, that the deficit forecast for the current year 16-17. They still have to make just under £46 million of savings to achieve that, and that will be challenging. It's more than double the savings they've made in prior years. So there is risk around the transformation plan, there's no doubt about it, but I think that the good positive thing is the board are totally engaged with that. They are talking closely with Scottish Government on a regular basis, and from what I've seen, they are certainly doing the right things.
But you fear that that could result in some posts, clerical and administrative, going?
I think that there are areas where they would indicate that they have more higher staffing in certain areas that you would compare to other boards. So there would indicate there may be opportunities over a period of time to reduce those numbers without impacting things. But that'd be something that the board would consider, and I'm sure we'd be able to talk to you about.
Final question. Has any NHS board in Scotland been in a similar financial predicament before?
In my time as Auditor General, this is the most challenging position I've seen. We have obviously in the slightly more dim and distant past had real challenges in the Western Isles and Argyll and Clyde Health Board, but they occurred before I had this responsibility, so I can't compare them in that sense.
Can I thank you very much indeed for your evidence today? We'll now move into private session.